Hello and welcome. This targeted event is brought to you by the Harvard Initiative for Learning and Teaching in partnership with VPAL Signature Events and the Harvard Alumni Association. Thank you for joining this morning. What do you do as an educator when someone brings up misinformation in your class? Moderated by Meira Levinson, join Neil McGaraghan, Eric Torres, and Shifali Singh as they discuss teaching in the age of misinformation and how we engage in thinking about and understanding misinformation. Without further ado, Meira, the virtual floor is yours.
Thank you so much. I really appreciate, Cassie, all the work that you guys have done to pull this together. And I'm really looking forward to learning from Eric and Shifali and Neil about their conceptions of this topic. And so to do that, let's just jump in. And why don't we go in this order, Eric, Shifali, then Neil. I'm really curious why you said yes to being a part of this panel.
First, thanks so much, Cassie, everybody at Hill for having me here. Delighted to be here with you, Neil and Meira and Shifali. I'll just say a little bit more about who I am briefly to sort of ground some of the reasons why I said yes to this. Like Cassie said, I'm a PhD student in the human development, or PhD candidate now, I guess, in the human development, learning and teaching strand of the PhD program. I also teach as a lecturer a course on talking politics under conditions of polarization at the Grad School of Education. I've done work on a variety of projects that are adjacent to the panel's topic. I've worked with Paul Harris on young children's trust in the testimony of adults, and some work on science learning and digital environments. But the sort of crux of my current research and work is on the theorizing about the epistemic goals of civic education, what kinds of classroom practices are conducive to those goals, and how we can measure key civic attitudes like tolerance. I also do some large-scale survey-based research on political attitudes. And for the last few years, I've taught this course that I designed on at the Ed School. So personally, I said yes to joining the panel because I think this is a great opportunity to share some of the things I'm working on. The Harvard community, Hilt in particular, is a great brain trust. I'm also really interested in hearing from other people about the practices that they've been developing, the problems they've been encountering. In terms of the content specifically, I think how we approach misinformation, and in particular, how we're defining and conceptualizing misinformation is really important right now, especially with some of these like emerging technology, AIs being trained in ways that may bake in conceptions of misinformation, governments and other influential actors thinking about regulating misinformation, but also, and most importantly, because the social conditions under which this conversation is happening make misinformation both particularly potent and I think worrisome in its role for exacerbating social divisions. So it just feels like a really critical time to be a part of this conversation, and I'm really excited to be here and get to hear from everybody.
Thanks, Eric. Shifali.
So I don't want to, you know, I thanks so much again for having me, and it's great to be here and just learn from everybody. My background, I'm primarily interested in digital mental health. Technology has been sort of the predominant modality of communication in our society. And so at Harvard for the undergrads, I teach technology and mental health, as well as myth busting pseudoscience and psychology. And with the technology and mental health course, it was really focused on sort of this increasing dissemination of information through technology. And as you know, the undergrads right now are experiencing more communication through technology than any other means. And so from, you know, this can be problematic from just not a social sort of psychological arena, but also from the, you know, mental health perspective and of course, misinformation and healthcare. So the class I'm teaching currently, which is Myth-Busting Pseudoscience and Psychology, really focuses on the ways that communication is sort of spread, the ways we interpret information, the ways information can be misconstrued, and sort of the ways that People can help try to discern from themselves what is right and what isn't, and how to look for evidence in a critical way. And so, like Eric said, I think this is a really sort of salient and important topic right now, more than ever, especially as we sort of transition into this more digital world. And so, really just excited to be here and speak with all of you.
And I'll echo the thanks and the appreciation for the chance to be here and the chance to just hear from others as well to get perspective and to get people's experience, how they've seen the topic show up for them and how they've seen the issues play out in classrooms, but also in the broader the context in which we're finding ourselves. And I share a lot of, I think, the things that both Eric and Shifali mentioned as reasons for being here and interests. My background, at least here at the law school, has been teaching negotiation, where we spend a lot of time helping people think about gaps in information, gaps in communication, and things that they can't understand or don't understand about others. And then, as Meira mentioned, I'm also teaching right this semester a reading group anyway on polarization and political dialogue. And of course, misinformation feeds heavily into polarization and how we communicate with each other. So I'm generally interested in the topic and how people communicate with each other, and misinformation these days is a part of the way we are all communicating, or communication that we are exposed to in any case. But I think for me, one of the things that's most interesting, and so my background before getting here was as a litigator for almost for about 20 years. And so much of litigation is based on characterizing everything else as misinformation and false information and wrong information. And my side is the right information. Just look over here. This is the stuff you need. And this over here is all, you know, baloney. And so I've always been really interested in that gap between what one says and what the other says and how it's characterized by the other, and figuring out what it's like, and particularly for people training to be lawyers, to avoid falling into that trap. And one of the things I'm most interested in is how we identify misinformation and where the lines of misinformation start and end. And there are some things we can objectively agree are factually wrong, and other things where I think it's challenging and important to look for the tiny little bit of the kernel of the truth, which we are sort of conditioned to ignore and push aside. Anyway, so those are some of the things that I find really fascinating, but also practically helpful for lawyers to think about as they get out into the world and start thinking about how to be less trapped by that dichotomy between misinformation, my information.
Thanks. All right, so I'm hearing two different domains around teaching the age of misinformation that the three of you have brought up. On the one hand, especially you, Shifali, but also the two of you, Neil and Eric, have brought up teaching students about what misinformation is, how and why it arises and spreads, who adopts it, you know, sort of understanding the ecosystem of misinformation and sort of the ecology and how it propagates and so forth. And that, you know, might be a, oh, look over there kind of thing, right? But then also I heard from each of you some concerns about students' own, and really all of our own, but especially since it's about teaching, we'll sort of focus on students' own vulnerability to misinformation. And so teaching them how to be, how to recognize it, combat it, address it, deal with it in their own work and in their own lives. And obviously these are highly related, right? It's hard to know how you would sort of define yourself as being perhaps subject to or even a vector for misinformation if you don't understand something about sort of the ecology of misinformation. And Eric and Shifali, you both particularly emphasized in a digital world. But at the same time, they feel somewhat different, right? You know, one can academically describe the misinformation that others are subject to, and that's different from, say, doing some of the kind of critical evaluative work and positioning work for oneself and thinking about when might I be subject to or a vector of misinformation. Can I ask, I don't know, we can go in sort of opposite order. We'll start with Neil this time and end with Eric. Like, do you focus on one or the other? Do you see this as a false dichotomy because you think that they're necessarily integrated? And then also, like, what is one thing that you do teach students that you think is particularly helpful and with one or both of these?
So if we're going in reverse order, I think that means me. I'll take the second part of that, which is I maybe focus on how to help people sort of think about their own, whether they're a vector, which I like the way of putting that. Yeah, maybe I'm the problem here. But I don't mean to turn it away from focus on the self, but I think part of the exercise for that is to be more curious about the other. So rather than starting with that's wrong as a way to get to some of my own sort of truth and the maybe vulnerability of some of the things that I think I believe or that I know very firmly that I believe, I guess, in many cases, is to be open to hearing something from somebody else about what seems to me like misinformation or deliberate sort of misdirection. And maybe, you know, looking for that kernel of truth or some way in which the thing that I came to this believing, which is that is so patently false. And so the thing that comes to mind for me is the claim of a stolen election. And I think by now there's pretty broad consensus that the claims of massive fraud are wrong and just factually untrue. But saying that the election was stolen from us is a different question. If I'm really interested in testing my own story, which is there was no theft, there was no fraud, everything was on the up and up, everything was fine. Maybe what I need to do is be a little bit more critical analytical view of what does this mean to have a stolen election? Where are there aspects of what happened in 2020 that there might be something of value, and not just for my own benefit, but for the larger conversation. So the trouble with a lot of this is that we don't have a conversation about anything that matters. And so fair elections matter, but we're not able to have a conversation about what might have been deemed unfair by many people because we start with that misinformation, because there is so much misinformation there, but is there a tiny bit? And so to help myself understand my own story, which is everything is fine in this election, there's nothing wrong, maybe I need to start by thinking a little bit more about where might there be something worth listening to from somebody else, where it's on the surface, I've allowed myself to believe it is complete nonsense. Just as an example, I don't want to pretend that I'm representing all of my actual views here, but that's one way to look at this.
So before we move on to Shivali, can I just ask, so this is sounding as if it's coming like from your negotiation, your teaching negotiation head on. So let me just see if I understand this correctly. You're basically saying, okay, the idea that there was actually election fraud, that we had large numbers of votes being miscounted, added into the system, that we had changes, et cetera, that's clearly false. That's clearly misinformation. The sense of being disenfranchised, the sense of not having the democratic process be responsive to one's wants and needs and desires and so forth, that seems legitimate, even if the form of expression, you know, the sort of the factual claims are wrong. And so let's try to have a conversation about that question of democratic inclusion. Is that sort of what you're saying?
I think that's a good part. That's where I would want someone, that's where I would want myself to get. And I would want to get there by starting with, okay, I have to just look a little deeper than the specific words that are being used, because we do talk in like little catchphrases too, and little sound bites and digestible, you know, tweets that allow us to categorize a huge problem and a huge process in a few characters. And so what do I need to do as someone who cares about identifying misinformation on the other side, but also where I might be subject to an overly optimistic view of the value of my side of things? How can I dig a little deeper? And yes, maybe we get to, what is it like to be disenfranchised? What is it like to have fairness in our system? What is it like to have a system of election day and election, I guess, process state laws that allow drop-off ballot, that allow mail-in voting, that allow ballots to be counted after the, we have to talk about those things. And until someone on one side is able to say, all right, there's something more here than just allegations of widespread fraud, mm-hmm. until we are open to that possibility, we can't have the underlying conversation. Yeah.
Thanks, Neil. Shifali.
Yeah, thank you. So I think it's, you know, in terms of your latter point, I think, you know, teaching is a really complex thing that, you know, that we have to do when we're trying to, you know, help someone try to understand why misinformation is spreading, how they can identify it. And, you know, I'd like to extend it not just teaching students, but also teaching my patients. So from the digital standpoint, the research, you know, says that people who come from low socioeconomic backgrounds or those who are part of the LGBTQIA plus community, they're more likely to seek information from online sources than from their doctor or healthcare provider. And so what's really interesting to me is that, you know, you see on things like TikTok, you know, platforms that are you know, so commonly used nowadays, that people are spreading information about healthcare and information about science. It's at this interesting sort of pivotal time where our society has been sort of very anti-science, more anti-science than almost any other time in history in the past several years, and anti-government as well. You know, in terms of, is the COVID vaccine safe? You know, what does the CDC say now about guidelines about, you know, self-quarantining? You know, and so there is this. It's interesting to see sort of this perception of misinformation and an increased willingness to accept misinformation as truth based on sort of like these preconceived sort of foundational issues that have resulted as part of our government and the general distrust. And so people turned more towards looking at authority figures for, you know, information, and now are looking to more social avenues for getting information. And I think it's important to acknowledge that as a society, that there has been a sense of a lack of trust in established things like the medical system and the government. And there is this sort of increased reliance upon each other as resources. When I ask my students, you know, where do you look for when you have a question about your healthcare? They're not saying, oh, I go on Patient Gateway and message my doctor, who may message back in 3 to 7 business days. They're saying, I'm going on Reddit, I'm going on TikTok. And, you know, I think that it's important to acknowledge that, yes, information is now coming from these sources that are traditionally unconventional and not necessarily backed by sort of any empirical, you know, basis. And so I think that acknowledging that first, that it's there, that it's present, that that's how we're learning things, is an important first step. And then understanding and teaching students about humility. And that's kind of what Neil touched on in the beginning, is that you have to have humility as a scientist. And we're all scientists, every single one of us. We all have hypotheses about how our days are going to go, and we test them out, you know? And so I think that it's a lot of work to do that every day, all the time, right? And then when you tack on all this information that we're getting, and we're getting so much more information than evolutionarily that we should have been getting, right? No caveman, you know, thousands of years ago was getting as much information and stimuli as we are. And so it's sort of this, in terms of, you know, from my neuropsychologist hat, it's a lot of cognitive load that we're sort of taking on right now. And so understanding, you know, hey, I may not be able to discern every single piece here, but I can have humility and say, hey, what evidence do I have? And what evidence might there be to refute this? And just having sort of that openness to and reception to the fact that you might be wrong, or that gut feeling that you have might not actually be backed by anything grounded in truth, I think is an important sort of psychological perspective to have.
So I would love to stick on this for a minute too, just like I was basically pressing Neil about questions about democracy. I want to press you about sort of these epistemic questions of knowledge, which seems like so core to this question about misinformation, because I mean, I would guess that some of your students would say back to you, Of course, we're not going to the, you know, medical industrial, you know, complex, like, as LGBTQ plus people, right? We were pathologized, you know, in the DSM until, you know, quite recently, right? There, that the American Medical Association, right, you know, claimed that we were actually suffering from disorders. Certainly the long COVID community would argue that it was through their digital activism and sharing of their symptoms that, you know, they were central to getting the medical community to start taking them seriously. And then the fibromyalgia people said, oh, we've been trying this right for decades. So I'm, you know, curious, how do you talk with students about this sort of, I mean, part of what we see, I think, in the digital world, particularly, including around health, is an assertion that some of it is anti-science, but some of it is, say, about citizen science, about, you know, challenging, self-appointed guardians. How do you talk about that?
Yeah, I think you're 100% right. I think that it is this dialectic that exists, right? And like I said, I first think it's important to acknowledge that this is how we're receiving information now. And that as someone who most all of my research is, well, not all of it, but most of my research is citizen science based. I am strongly rooted in the idea that the best research we can do is within our community and not in our ivory towers. And so, you know, I think that acknowledging that, yes, this is potentially the best information that you're going to get because you have so much more data points than maybe your one doctor who may be an outlier, right? But it's important to be able to understand what information you're getting and the content and sort of what evidence is backing the content of the information you're getting. For the LGBTQ community, the information that they get online, certainly on average, is probably extremely beneficial, extremely useful, and accurate, right? On the whole. But of course, there are going to be some things that are just not. And so again, adopting it with that sense of, okay, this is probably the best source of information I can get, but what facts hold true for me that may not hold true for these people? And how can I substantiate or refute some of the things that I'm seeing? Potentially it can cause, and then also something I focus a lot on in class is how these myths can do harm, right? And so understanding, you know, that yes, these kinds of conversations, like you know, in the mental health community, there's a lot of glorification of suicide online, right? And so certainly people may empathize with that and say, yes, I feel this way, and maybe this means I should go and do this. But understanding what sort of being able to sort of separate yourself from the information that you're reading is really, really hard when you're so inundated, and acknowledging that, yes, I'm inundated in this right now, and I can separate myself and I can try to do some of my own research is a complex task, but is something that I try to encourage students to do.
Thanks, Shivali. Eric,
wherever you want. So much of what Neil and Shafali have said resonates with me, and I want to synthesize some ideas that I heard emerge from the two of them about, like, both the importance of humility and the social foundations of misinformation. I tend to approach thinking about misinformation and encourage my students to see misinformation as an important part of an issue of trust networks, is the term the philosopher Tony Layden has used. And I, in my class, I actually don't spend a ton of time trying to diagnose or identify misinformation as such. And I'll talk about the reasons for that a little bit later. But I think this issue of misinformation as, there's a particular kind of misinformation that usually comes up in my class. And this is maybe a controversial conception of misinformation, but it's the kind of misinformation that involves really distorted perceptions of people on the other side of the political aisle, or in the other side of sort of like an ideological issue. And there's a ton of research in political science, political psychology, that shows that we're pretty bad at characterizing what people on the other side tend to think about things. We're bad at we're bad at identifying their the demographic composition of the out party. We're even worse at estimating what they think about some of the issues. Just as one example that I'm using actually in a lecture this afternoon, there's a really interesting survey. They asked, you ask Democrats, like, what proportion of Republicans think any amount of immigration is good for the country? Democrats say, well, less than half, probably like 40%. In fact, it's like 80%. And similarly, if you ask Republicans, what proportion of Democrats think that most police are decent people? They'll say less than half, 40%. In fact, it's about 80%. And this particular kind of misinformation, I want to call it misinformation, is especially consequential because it drives feelings of disdain, alienation, social distance, and that produces these social incentives to ignore narratives that are coming out of the oppositional community, these critical narratives of information that might be circulating within our own trust networks. And so the way that I deal with this pedagogically is sort of twofold. I mean, first is that there's good research that kind of shows merely exposing people to information that brings their perceptions of members of the outgroup more in line with reality can dial down some of those incentives to ignore critiques that might be really important for them to hear that are coming from the other side, to points that I think both Neil and Shifali have made about the importance of engaging in humility. I think this is one of the things that can lubricate that kind of thinking. I also spend a fair amount of time thinking about the social dynamics of the classroom and the conditions under which we're engaging in inquiry. I think the goal, there's again, a lot of research that shows kind of surprisingly that just encouraging people to pursue using accuracy primes, encouraging people to pursue accuracy as they assess information is actually like a pretty good nudge to get them away from what some people would talk about as socially motivated reasoning or selectively seeking out sources of information that confirm our biases.
Can you explain what an accuracy prime is?
Yeah, something as simple as saying like, hey, we remember as you're thinking about this, that the goal is to seek to accurately assess information. Like we're trying to be critical thinkers here. And it seems such a minor thing, but Gordon Pennycook did a great meta-analysis last year. And it's pretty potent, both in the context of misinformation and in reasoning in general. Establishing as an educator that, you know, we as peers in this learning community are going to have a lot of different views about things. That's natural. We're going to disagree about things. But let's keep in mind that the process that we're undertaking is one of inquiry. We're trying to get to the right answers. And so by doing some of that norming, we can diffuse some of the social incentives that I think create the conditions under which misinformation of other kinds, specific kinds, can propagate. And so I guess in part, or the foundation of my approach is really tackling this misinformation about people on the other side, about others as epistemic agents, and getting us into a place where we can do that process of inquiry about any individual issue where we're focused on accuracy.
Thank you. This is already such a mind-expanding conversation. So it sounds to me as if all three of you in many ways are trying to challenge the idea that there's a sharp dichotomy between information and misinformation. You're basically suggesting more of a continuum that therefore we want to sort of approach with humility, like, right, that part of it is we can't be sure where we are, right? And, you know, so Neil was talking about looking for the nuggets of truth. Shifali, you were talking about say, recognizing the ways in which in our everyday lives, we are actually scientists. And so trying to sort of use our scientific capacities to assess, evidence as it comes to us in all sorts of ways. And all three of you have also been talking about trying to learn more about the other and sort of getting ourselves out of various kinds of bubbles, right? Those are bubbles around certain approaches to mental health that may be dangerous, or those are bubbles of ideological assumptions about, political opponents or whatever, and trying to open ourselves up to a much greater range of knowledge. And in many ways, that sounds very appealing and very aligned with, say, the mission of the university, of our helping our students broaden their conception of knowledge, of research, of sources of information, become good critical inquirers into that, learn a whole variety of disciplinary tools to help them gain knowledge, etc. At the same time, there is true disinformation. I mean, so we might then so one of our attendees has written in the Q&A, it sounds like we're discussing misinformation in the context of good faith engagement, but commonly misinformation is accompanied by bad faith engagement. How do we engage with bad faith engagement that weaponizes misinformation? And oftentimes, say, then the term might be, instead of misinformation, right, where people are perhaps authentically confused, they're disinformation, active attempts to get people to believe things that even the agent of propagating that information knows is wrong, right? And so I wonder, what do we do in the face of that? And is it that we're leaning into the humility, the understanding that most people on the other side aren't propagators of disinformation, and at best they might be misinformed, et cetera? And how do we help our students distinguish between misinformation and disinformation, particularly when, as you pointed out, Eric, the features of our trust networks and these distorted conceptions of the other side often lead us to charge those on the other side with being active agents of disinformation rather than perhaps, unwitting dupes of misinformation.
May I?
Yes.
Okay, great. So that question in the Q&A I saw also and made me think, along with one of the things there, or I guess it was that sort of the accuracy label notion that if you prompt people, they're able to actually be more accurate, which suggests that if you don't prompt them, I don't want to put words in Eric's mouth, but I'm thinking if I don't give the prompt, it's possible that people are going to be delivering information that on some level they know is not as accurate as it could be. And there's a study that we read about in the reading group that I'm reading this semester that says that a lot of people actually share information online that is deliberately false and is intended to sort of mischaracterize and demonize the other side. That's the whole point of it. And it's not necessarily just by mistake or inadvertence or, oops, I thought that was true. It's you're going out to the far reaches of the internet, and this happens on both sides of the spectrum, although according to these people who studied this more often on the further right, they're finding information on purpose that is meant to harm the other side. And because it's an us and them, we've got to win this battle between us, which leads me to think that one of the things that's going on, it's not the information that's actually the issue. If you could get people together, it's there's something else going on besides the facts or the misfacts, the falsehoods. There's something more relational that's happening under the surface. So whether it's being open to considering this as possibly sort of valuable information is maybe not quite the issue in that case. Maybe there's a person there that is worth engaging with on some level. And if we're getting able to get past the us and them through facilitated dialogue, through engaged in learning classrooms together, following accuracy labels, however it is, to get people to focus on the people rather than on the misinformation, maybe is one way to get at this. And so I don't want to be too Pollyannish about it, because people trying to hurt others sounds like a pretty bad dynamic. And it's happening all over the place. It's a reality. And that I don't think that those are all bad people, but the team dynamic, the us and them, the sort of the camps that we polarize into are very powerful and drive a lot of this behavior. Eric, I expect you know a lot more about this than I do. It sounds like it's within your zone of study. And Shifali, what you mentioned about the way this happens with actually life and death, potentially like healthcare and health related information, is maybe a different thing to be thinking about altogether. But at the political level, in any case, having people in the same room talking to each other about themselves rather than about the information they're trying to share, I think has a way of letting some of the pressure off of the need to use misinformation and misdirected information to hurt others. That was kind of what occurred to me when I saw that question and listening to the other speakers.
Thanks, Neil. Would others like to respond to this? And as either Eric or Shifali unmute, I will say, as hopefully attendees can figure out, I'm starting to look at the questions and bring them in. So if you have them, please feel free to put them in.
I really liked Neil's points there, and as well as Eric's, just about accuracy, labeling. And so from the healthcare perspective, I think it's a lot easier to tell a patient with conviction that something is misinformation, right? But you can't control what kind of information they're consuming out there. And so, you know, that in that way, technology has been really, really helpful in terms of developing apps, like especially around women's reproductive health, right? Being able to educate people and having board certified OBGYNs coming in and sort of like writing articles. So in that way, I think that there has been in the healthcare space a bit of movement, but of course not as much as we'd like. But from the perspective of, you know, the agent of propagation of disinformation, oftentimes, you know, many have convinced themselves that, sort of Neil, to your point of nuggets of truth, they have convinced themselves that the disinformation is actually truth or some sort of extension of the truth, right? And so from the humility perspective in this case, we might think about, and I encourage my students to think about how and why people are incentivized to spread misinformation. Now, on social media, that might just be to get attention, to get followers, to get likes, to become famous, to adopt this idea as your own, right? And that alone is such a huge source of misinformation currently, especially in the healthcare system. We have med influencers going on that have no medical training, but you know, teach about these types of procedures that people can do, and it's problematic. So I think, you know, I would say that when people are able to understand how others who are spreading misinformation are incentivized, and you know, separating the information from the person, like we've talked about, I think they're better able to kind of internalize this as information I'm getting from this person instead of this is the ground truth.
Yeah, I'd love to pick up on that a little bit. I mean, I think first I'll back up and say, I mean, to me, the solution to misinformation, disinformation, and you know, just general like empirical misunderstandings or lack of awareness about issues, and it is really just doing the bread and butter work of rigorous inquiry in each of our disciplines and teaching students how to do that in their day-to-day lives. And relatedly, I'm not entirely sure that the average person now has worse understandings of the world than they did at any time in the past. That may be the case. I do think we're in a particularly sort of complex information environment, and I do think it's pretty clear that there are more motivated disinformation actors out there. But that's an empirical question to which I don't intuitively know the answer, and I haven't seen research that's sort of been dispositive on that. I mean, I do think there's an important conversation to be had about whether a given bit of information warrants the label of misinformation or disinformation. But I actually, as I mentioned this before, I think determining whether that label applies is actually something that we probably want to de-emphasize in a lot of settings. in favor of just doing this, the kind of inquiry that we would with respect to like any claim that we encounter, whether or not that that label applies. And part of the reason for that is because we've touched on this, and I think Neil has made this clear, is that the label of misinformation is pretty highly moralized. It suggests not just that some claim about the world is wrong, but that it's either motivated by sinister purposes or bad intellectual hygiene, and that people who have latched onto it have either been duped or are lying to themselves, or they themselves are doing some kind of lying. And none of this is particularly easy for people to accept, particularly if it's coming from someone who is not in your trust network. I think Shefali's point about like a trusted medical provider who's able to just come out and say, hey, look, we have this good relationship, you trust me, and I can tell you straight out that this is misinformation, that's great. And I think that is, under conditions where you have that kind of trusting relationship, that can be some easy shorthand to getting past any given bit of misinformation that somebody might have in circulation in their heads. But oftentimes we can get, like if we just jump to labeling something as misinformation, we can get reactionary effects because of this highly moralized nature of the claim. And because the claim in some ways like bypasses the process of inquiry in order to land on the conclusion. We say like that is an illegitimate thought rather than, hey, let's take a look at the evidence for that thought and see if it does hold water. So I think obviously, you know, for reasons of resource intensity and our own personal expertise, like not every bit of what may be misinformation can be subject to that rigorous process of inquiry. And again, where we have the authority and where we ourselves are confident that our own biases are not skewing how we define misinformation one way or another, which is something that I think we all really have to be vigilant about. I think it can be really helpful to engage in that conversation about whether something qualifies as mis or disinformation. But for the most part, I think my intuition is that just doing this, the work that we all do in our teaching as disciplinarians and have been for a long time, is probably the most robust way to get to make people less susceptible to misinformation and better thinkers and reasoners in a variety of contexts.
Thanks. All right. So I'm going to start doing sort of a rapid fire set of questions that are going to be hard to answer rapid fire, but we're going to try. We're getting a bunch of questions in the Q&A related to media literacy. Like, are there specific things that we could teach students or ourselves that would actually support people in being able to identify and avoid misinformation, or alternatively, like if we want to leave aside the misinformation term, that like I think about Sam Weinberg's work at the Stanford History Education Group, where he studied historians and students and fact checkers, and basically it talks about how fact checkers work in a totally different way from others, where they move horizontally sort of across different sources rather than like digging deep into one source in order to assess trustworthiness. And so he's now developed a curriculum that is basically trying to teach K-12 students and undergraduate students how to, he calls it moving laterally. He basically says, you know, the way to assess whether something is true is not to try to figure out whether the single source you're looking at is true, because there can be lots of misguiding elements. It can be a really pretty web design with lots of charts and graphs and some quotes, and that then seems really trustworthy. And he says, no, move laterally and see, you know, whether other sources basically seem to affirm or challenge these perspectives. So, all right, that's my one offering based on Sam Weinberg's research of a specific technique that we might teach ourselves and others to try to achieve, you know, better sources of knowledge. Quick round, is there anything else that you guys would suggest?
I'll only offer maybe a slight addition to it, which is at least for me, I do this when I come across something that doesn't seem right to me. And I've got one person in particular I'm thinking of who's a good friend who frequently dumps stuff in my inbox that I think this just doesn't sound right. And I can do the work that you just said, this lateral process of, first of all, looking at what I was given and then finding other things to disprove. I never, almost never, take the time to sort of look into the things that sound right to me. Oh, that sounds right. Why don't I take a look? And so I just would, I guess I'd offer maybe as frequently as I give my own, myself this advice, as frequently as I think something sounds off and I want to dig in and check it, do the same thing with the things that seem on, that seem right, that seem like consistent with the way I see the world. Okay, why? Because it's very easy for me to go out and take pot shots at the things that I know that sound wrong to me. But if I want to, and getting back to where we started a little bit, how do I test my own, whether I'm the vector here? Why shouldn't I be looking into the sources that seem to me like they are the ones that make sense, that are implicitly the more believable, more credible?
Yeah, I'll run with that really briefly. I mean, I think one of the values of this, the Weinberg approach, is that it can introduce, like, where there are things that we wouldn't have thought of to question by reading broadly. This is sort of like a marketplace of ideas approach. By reading broadly, we might be exposed to criticisms of those ideas that wouldn't have intuitively occurred to us because of our own propensities to just sort of absorb information that we want to hear. And so what you can do is by surface, like looking for, actively seeking out sort of like contrary perspectives, you can then tee up some points of inquiry that you might not have that might not have occurred to you, and then you kind of, I think it's both a deep, a wide and deep thing. You say, okay, what counts as reasonable evidence for defeating this, you know, claim, and can I find that? I think this again goes back to what can be thought of under the umbrella of sort of an accuracy, a community of inquiry, accuracy motivated thinking, but baking in some of these habits of seeking out alternative perspectives and not just reading within our silos.
I'll just add quickly a point of, you know, it's been difficult for me actually to teach this, because while I love to say, like, yes, go out and, like, every time you see something, you know, that's misinformation, look at all of these different sources and do the work, ultimately, it's really hard to do that in our daily lives, you know? And that's something I struggle with convincing my students. Like, I can teach all I want about, like, how, you know, how we should look at varied sources and not send things that just because they're interesting to us, right? But then it's like, how can we quickly do the work? And so that's a conversation I had with my students last week. And I was saying, like, how do you check for misinformation really, really quickly on like TikTok or social media? And they said, oh, I typically look at the comments and then I aggregate, like, how many comments are saying, is this real versus not? And they sort of adopt these like heuristics, right? And so it's like, I don't have a good answer, because I think it's really just a complex question. And I don't know how ecologically, you know, the ecological validity of it, right? Like, how often in our daily lives can we do all of this work? And so I think what might make sense is to say, hey, I have heuristics about these certain types of information. Maybe let's go in and say, like, okay, I'm accepting this as interesting, but I'm not going to accept it as truth, and making that sort of assertion, sort of staying in the gray area, trying to not change or let one piece of information alter your thinking too much in the time, like in sort of just in time.
Thanks. Yeah. I mean, I think this point about heuristics is really important. And actually this gets us in ways back to, Eric, you had mentioned Paul Harris, a colleague of ours at the Ed School, who does research on trust and knowledge in young children. And he points out that young children have to just trust, like, most of what they learn, right? Like, you know, learning is a matter of trust. And that's true actually for all of us in most things, you know, whether or not some of us suddenly decided to try to become infectious disease epidemiologists on the side for the last few years, or, you know, some people have tried to become climate scientists on the side, you know, for the last few years. We have, there's a whole, you know, most of our lives we lead trusting that actually experts, you know, have done, you know, are have done the right things, right? We can't, you know, we're not, you know, there may be small things we suddenly try to learn about air quality or about AI or about, you know, self-driving cars, but we don't learn, look into air, like that's just most of our world. We actually have to trust that those who are doing the work know what they're doing. And so I think this question of heuristics and when we decide to follow, try to ferret out evidence and when we don't is a really important question, because we can't live our entire lives, right? Questioning everything, because that's a recipe for incoherence. All right, so here's a second quick question that cannot be answered quickly. And this was raised, Eric, when you were talking about the moral dimensions of calling something misinformation, right? Because the fact value distinction, right, is one that's in fact been questioned in various ways, right? Whether as we think about, say, you know, many claims about the world have very strong moral valences. And so I was actually, so as I, so I was following the fallout over Scott Adams, the Dilbert cartoonist, and his racist rants on YouTube last week and the dropping of his cartoons. One of the examples of misinformation that he has clearly fallen prey to is the idea that African Americans do not value education. I listened to about 20 minutes of his YouTube video before I gave up and stopped. But in there, part of what he was going off about was the idea that, you know, we white people should be with people who value education, and that clearly doesn't include Black people because of, if you look at differences in Black academic and educational achievement, clearly they don't value education. That I know as an expert in part in American educational history is wrong, right? That I mean, I know that actually African-American schools that African-Americans helped to set up after the Civil War for self-education were the grounds of the spreading of actually public education in most states other than Massachusetts across the US, that in fact denying Blacks access to education and to literacy to the point of threatening them with death if they demonstrated the capacity to read and write were some of the tools of white supremacy in order to keep Black people enslaved and then oppressed after the Civil War. So that is an example to me very clearly of misinformation that has profound political and moral consequences. At the same time, there are, you know, that I am making there a moral and political and epistemic set of claims. And as we talk with one another, we are all, you know, sort of taking these stances around how we relate factual information to the moral credibility, and going back to what you were talking about, Neil, at the beginning around democracy, the democratic credibility and the extent to which we are willing to extend respect to one another as fellow citizens. And so this wasn't a quick question, I apologize. But I guess this is the final thing I would ask you. As we try to help our students embrace humility, get outside themselves and their own networks of moral knowledge as well as factual knowledge, how do we also help them stand up for moral principles that we believe in and that we might want them to believe in?
I'll take a stab at this. I mean, this is a really tough one in some senses. I mean, I think on the one hand, I don't think anything that intellectual humility is incompatible with holding really firm, humanizing moral dispositions. I also don't think that a worry, these like boundary concerns about how we draw the line between what ought to be entertained as emerging from like outside of our trust network in a way that like we should be open to it versus just being some noxious, morally noxious or empirically really unfounded bit of information that we should sort of steel ourselves against. That boundary issue will always exist in all of us as we think about our interfacing with information. I think we need to teach our students to be attentive to those boundaries. In general, I mean, you know, to your point, Meira, it seems like in the case of, I'm not up to date on this.
You do not need to follow Dilbert cartoonists.
Yeah. But I mean, you know, in some ways, I would think that sunlight is the best disinfectant. Like you said, those attitudes, those sort of like racist attitudes that he's propagating are empirically falsifiable. Or even if they are to some degree, like there's a conjectural element where there's a person who might like just hold a belief that doesn't reduce to some easily falsifiable claim. I think, again, the sort of like general standards of inquiry can, you know, purge a lot of that kind of thinking from serious consideration. I also think that it's perfectly important, not perfectly fine and important to affirm certain sets of democratic values about the dignity of people, and that like these can be foundations and guideposts to how we go about our inquiry. That in and of itself is complicated, but you know, I don't think there's anything paradigmatically impossible about having this sort of like generally humble orientation towards information that's coming from outside of our trust networks, while also being vigilant about, you know, particularly sort of noxious ideas that might be worthy of dispute.
Great. Thanks, Eric. Neil and Shefali, you each get about 45 seconds.
Sorry for going long.
No, it's fine. It's my fault. Go ahead, Shefali.
Neil, you can go ahead if you'd like. I'm still okay. I mean, I feel like, you know, morality is a heavy, you know, it's a very heavy thing to tie to misinformation, I think, because it ascribes something psychologically about a person that attaches them to the information that they're spreading. So that's just something I think we should be aware of too when we're having this morality discussion. You know, we don't totally know this person's lived experience or why they sort of developed these beliefs in the first place. And so I think that it's okay. I think that morality should be tied to misinformation, and that misinformation can do harm, especially like, you know, we see with all these digital mental health apps that are like sending Adderall prescriptions to people's houses for filling out two questions, you know, like that's a moral question, right? And that's misinformation. But in terms of like, you know, and then if you trace it back to like the company founder themselves, like, do you think they're actually doing harm? Are they a morally bad person? Right. And I think that, we just really have to be careful. I would love to expand a bit more, but I know I have like negative 10 seconds. So I'll leave it at that.
Thanks, Shefali. Neil, final 10 seconds.
Okay. I can plus one, I think, in 10 seconds, or plus one to each. That's plus two. But also just to say that this is a question we engage in our class too. I'd still like to think that there is some engagement that can happen even with a person like that. And these are conclusions that he's putting out there and not facts, right? And so it's valuable on some level to understand what brings somebody to that conclusion so that we understand better where it's coming from and maybe can do something different about it, or help to see facts a different way, or present different facts that could cause someone to reach a different conclusion. The question is, who has to do that work? Because this is really potentially harmful to some people to have to sit in a room and have that conversation with this person on this topic. And so where do you draw lines around, yes, this is important to have this conversation. It's a lovely academic question, but it's also harmful in very real ways to people. And so it's hard to put, to clearly identify whose job that is and when and in what format and in what context do you actually engage with somebody who's taking what appears to many of us like a morally bankrupt position, but also a harmful and anyway, now that's my time is up too. But
thank you, Neil. I really appreciate it. Many thanks to all three of you and you. The HILT team. And let me pass it over to Cassie to close us out.
Thanks, Meira.
Thank you.
Thank you, Meira, Neil, Shifali, and Eric. And thanks to all of you who have joined us today. We'll hope you join for more targeted and signature events soon. Thank you for joining.